Buenos días, buenas tardes, buenas noches. Mi nombre es Alixa García y es un honor estar con ustedes. I am from Medellín, Colombia, and I am connecting with you from New York. I have been a visual artist, a poet, a musician, a filmmaker, an educator, a facilitator, and an activist, or as I like to refer to myself, a cultural architect. For the last 17 years, I feel like as artists, our role is to make the invisible visible. And in this time of great unknown and of chronic instability, I'm learning and leaning less into the foreseen and more into the unknown, which is the home of imagination. I feel like art is the great activator. And I want to share with you a quick story that I think really shares this as an example. And I was on tour with Climbing Poetry, a group I co-founded with Naima Penniman. And we've toured for years. We've done sustainable touring. We did 11,000 miles on a bus converted to run on recycled vegetable oil. You can check out the website. We've done so much, climbingpoetry.com. Anyways, we were on tour with this piece called Hurricane Season, The Hidden Messages in Water. And the piece addressed the intersections of state violence, displacement, and environmental injustice through rhyme, music, theater, film, and ritual. And many years later, as the Black Lives Matter movement began to grow and like just come on the scene, it was just coming on the scene. It was like maybe 2013, 2014. We came across a group of people who were meeting in a peace pagoda. And one of them, after seeing us, pulled us aside and said, "I was at that show you did in Rhode Island back in 2009. I was a teenager then. And the production opened my eyes to the intersections of oppressions and placed me as a Black male in the world in a way I didn't understand before then. And now I'm the chapter leader for Black Lives Matter East Coast. And in a huge way, it was because of what I saw that day. And I share that because art has this powerful tool of not only informing us, but inspiring us into action, placing us in the world. I'm gonna share just a small excerpt of a much longer essay that I wrote. You can find this essay on my website for the nitty-gritty scientific details, which I will skip because it's something really you want to take in anyways and with your eyes and read and memorize and learn and whatnot. But this is the more poetic side of it, and I feel like it really speaks to what I'm thinking about right now in this time and what I hope many of us are thinking about or starting to think about. And here goes this. Sunrise over Brooklyn during the heart of a pandemic can be insomniatic. The quiet streets cut by sirens accentuate the emergency state of a world on fire. I don't usually suffer from lack of sleep. I wonder if it's the premature lives turned ghosts hovering just above my house, wishing for a witness that have kept me awake. Or maybe it's my own animal instinct, so acutely aware that we indeed are sitting inside the epicenter of the next great extinction. Let's take a breath. As humans, we make up just 0.01% of all life. But we have destroyed 83% of wild mammals and roughly half of all flora on planet Earth. The extinction rate is up to 200 species per day. By the end of this year, roughly 67,000 species will be forever gone. Mostly unnoticed, life around us quietly disappears under the chaos of our human rumble. 2020, an abrupt stop. It was only a matter of time before our disturbed sleep forced us awake, turning our ears to the deafening echo of their silent departure. A delayed reaction, like most things human. The story may very well go something like this. Oh, how this house of cards came barreling down, us on top, positioned to fall the farthest, our souls chasing after us as we came crashing into the great abyss of ever after. I wonder if our souls will look back from an undisclosed location, slightly shell-shocked from the impact of having lost planet Earth on the 11th hour, falling the farthest because we knew what we had. We knew what we had to change, and we simply refused to do it. Without Earth drawing us back towards one another, where will our souls hover in the eternity of the universe? Created from stardust and charged with witnessing the universe unfold, we were intricately woven and given the perfect tools of poetry and technology, resistance and intellect, math and philosophy, memory and ritual. We were given compassion as a map. We were given love as a compass. And yet, we are so close to untethering ourselves from the fabric of life itself. Could it be that greed and complacency might actually be the truth tellers of who we have become? A cross uppercut knockdown of the potential of our divinity? The Earth is giving us one last chance. She is teaching us to be still, to listen, to care for the ones who care for us, to protect our elders and each other. Most importantly, she is showing us that she can heal herself. We are being offered an incredible opportunity to step away from a cascade of tipping points that could send multiple Earth systems marching past the edge of no return. This virus has shown us that in the face of danger and death, as a global community, we can instantaneously at that redirect our action, expand our imagination, and make a way out of inconceivable paths. I can see our souls reaching down as we fall from the edge, offering to pull us back into life like the air returning into smog-strangled cities. This is where the new story begins. What is required of us is nothing short of becoming imaginal, no longer under the hypnotic note of convenience. In the heart of extinction, we woke up to the imagined dream. And as we rise to the cyclical news of COVID-19, let us not forget the myriad ways we ourselves have been ensuring our extinction for decades. Will we keep our eyes open? Will we divest from the monsters that promise to eat us whole? I, not unlike you, have been guilty of participating in comfort economies while the earth begs us to breathe. Now it is we who are begging to breathe. Will we plant gardens and collaborate with the earth? Will we demand just systems to ensure our participation? Will we participate in our own rescue? Will we activate our imagination in this great pause? Will we teach our children to love this world back into existence? As the sun now rises directly into my eyes, I'm left wondering if the stars will eulogize us as the perfect reflection of the cosmos gone awry. Will they permanently ink the universal scrolls with stories of how our greed and complacency kept us from ever joining the celestial destiny set before us? Or will they eulogize us as part of their cohort, our stardust bodies having realized on the 11th hour that indeed we could change everything, and we